You're probably confused between digestion and absorption, and I want to clear up any craziness when it comes to that, because quite honestly, they're two very different processes. And I promise you, if you understand the difference between digestion and absorption, it's going to give you an entirely different perspective on what you're putting in your body and how it's utilized to ultimately allow you to get the most out of your life, but also get in the best possible shape. You see, a lot of this confusion comes from what we typically see on labels of certain things. So particularly probiotics. If we look at probiotics, a lot of times on the label, they will say promotes healthy digestion. And the reason that causes confusion is because it's wrong. But it's wrong only because the FDA kind of regulates what companies can and cannot say. And unfortunately, probiotics work more on the absorption side, but the FDA doesn't allow those companies to talk about absorption, particularly on a label, because that's making more of a claim. And everything's going to make some sense here in one second. You see, when we look at digestion, digestion is a mechanical aspect, more of the churning and the chewing and the breaking down. Whereas absorption is a very chemical, very cellular process that has to do a lot with what's going on in the body as far as the immune system and as far as our cells go. So it's very hard to make claims upon absorption without lots of clinical trials. Digestion, it's a little bit easier to make a claim on. So that's where things get confusing, and it all has to do with where the legality is. So forget all of that. Let's talk about how this actually works. First off, let's start with digestion. All you need to really know about digestion is the process of making food smaller, period. And it starts with chewing. It starts with the mechanical breakdown. Okay, we break food down in our mouth to make it smaller. Then it goes into our system, and we have enzymes that make it smaller, and churning of the stomach that makes it smaller. We always overcomplicate things. Digestion is making food into molecules, and those molecules into even smaller absorbable molecules, ultimately being utilized and then absorbed, of course. So let's take a look really quick at what happens. You take a bite of something, you chew it for a little bit, but you also have an enzymatic function that occurs. You have amylase in your saliva that starts to break the food down right then and there. A little bit of a chemical response. Then you swallow it, goes into your stomach churns, and it mechanically digests it more. Okay, then you have different enzymes that are in your stomach and your small intestine that break it down even further, along with some hydrochloric acid. Then after that, it starts to have a little bit of a different response where it's actually absorbed. But what's going on with digestion is we have enzymes that are acting upon different things that we eat. For example, carbs, proteins, and fats all have different enzymes that ultimately break them down in terms of digestion. Carbs, for instance, end up getting broken down by enzymes that ultimately turn carbohydrates into monosaccharides and disaccharides and things like that that are easily utilized by the body. Then, of course, when we look at fats, there's a different process. There's a process with lipase, there's a process with bile salts. It's a lot more complex. We're ultimately emulsifying fat into a smaller, more usable form. But at the end of the day, it's the same, whether it's carbs, proteins, or fats. All we are doing is making food smaller, period. So now let's get into the fun part, assimilation, absorption. This is where it's different. You see, absorption is literally the actual utilization and the absorption of those nutrients out of the digestive system and into the bloodstream. And this is a little bit more fun. It starts with the epithelial layer, also known as the epithelium. So epithelium is in our small intestine, and it's lined with lots of little finger-like particles that stick out in our intestinal tract. Okay, these finger-like particles increase the surface area of our intestines so that we can absorb more of the previously digested smaller food. So what ends up happening is this food is broken down into molecules and it travels through the small intestine and is ultimately absorbed through cells. But through these cells, they enter into the bloodstream through two unique ways. Okay, when it comes down to carbs and proteins, they enter through what are called capillaries, very, very small blood vessels. And these capillaries ultimately dump into what's called the portal vein. So the portal vein goes into the liver. So when we have the portal vein, we ultimately are dumping all the carbohydrates and the protein into the liver eventually so that the liver can filter, process, and do what needs to be done, and ultimately either store those carbohydrates as extra glycogen in the liver or disperse them to where they need to go. So most of the stuff that we consume goes into the portal vein and ends up in the liver. But then fats do something a little bit different. Fats don't go right into the bloodstream. I don't know if you knew this or not, but fats have a little bit of a different process. But it still roots down with the digestion. The fats are broken down by the lipase, by the bile salts and all that, and they're ultimately emulsified. They still cross through that endothelial layer, But they cross into the lymphatic system. Then they cross into the bloodstream eventually once they're broken down into further free fatty acids. And then after a little bit of time, they end up through the portal vein into the liver. So they're not going directly to the liver like carbohydrates and proteins are. They're going on a little bit of a field trip and then circulating and then ending up in the liver. We ultimately do need those fats to get to the liver because that's how we produce ketones. If you're in ketosis or doing a low carb diet, we want that. We also need to process fats for just security reasons, to make sure there's no toxins or anything like that. But ultimately, they don't go straight to the liver. Anyway, we'll talk about that in another video. But what's ultimately going on here is this process of taking food from the intestinal tract and utilizing it in the bloodstream and utilizing it by the cells is what's really, really important here. So now let's connect the dots with the whole probiotics thing. See, probiotics aren't really helping you digest. They're not enzymes. They're not there to help you break down food. They're not really doing any of that. Where the confusion lies is the fact that probiotics can help absorption, just can't really talk about it. And how they help absorption is by supporting the gut mucosal layer. So here's what happens. That mucosal layer has three different layers, actually. And it makes it very, very, very particular with what the body can absorb. It's a protective mechanism. But what ends up happening is over time, if we're eating poor foods or if we're making bad lifestyle choices, that mucosal layer breaks down. But it also breaks down if we have a lot of bad bacteria in the gut. And when that mucosal layer breaks down, it opens up gaps so that bigger food particles can get in. Well, that's not good. It defeats the whole purpose of digestion. Remember, with digestion, we were trying to make food small. So what good is digestion if our intestinal tract will just let giant chunks of food in? Because those giant chunks of food can't be metabolized and absorbed. They're just excreted, or they trigger an immune response and make us sick. So what ends up happening is probiotics like L-rhamnosis and some of the other strains have been researched to actually support the gut mucosal layer, to add more of it, but also stop the breakdown of it. So thereby, they're helping absorption. But again, where people get confused is probiotics do a lot more than just affect absorption. Probiotics are more about the connection between the symbiotic relationship of the bacteria and just our overall well-being and our brain and how things happen in our bodies. It's much, much more than just absorption or digestion. But if we understand that there is that difference, we start to understand that probiotics are a deeper connection with our body. They do more than just help us with breakdown of food. The right kind of probiotics support that symbiotic relationship that allows us to have the right kind of cravings, allows us to have the right gut-brain axis so we think clearer, and allows us to have a stronger immune system. Those are the things we really want to be focusing on, not whether taking a probiotic is going to help us break down that banana a little bit better. Anyhow, this should clear some things up. And if you have ideas for future videos, particularly in the world of digestion, gut-brain axis, and the gut biome, let me know in the comment section down below. I'll see you soon.